Hey, San Diego. Cathryn with Alive in San Diego with two of my favorite human beings. That's Ian McCartor and that's Dave Booda. Welcome, gentlemen.
Hey, it's good to be here.
How are you guys?
It's been nice here.
It's been nice in this old little thing.
So when did you guys become friends? When did you meet and how did you meet? I'm just curious.
Memories are not memories. My strong suit.
But most recently, you locked yourselves in an office for an entire day, like an office day, 8 hours, yeah. 9 to 5.
Yeah.
But instead of balancing books, you were writing songs. Dave, this was your little songwriter lock-in. Can you tell
my
me about it?
Parents have said, you know, get a job, Dave. So I'm like, all right, Mom, I'm going to go 9 to 5 in an office for one day.
Glad you're trying it.
So there's a book called The Frustrated Songwriter's Handbook. Have you heard of that?
I haven't.
It's an amazing book.
I just got it yesterday.
It's great.
And Frustrated?
The Frustrated Songwriter's Handbook.
Okay.
And I read it, and I loved it. And one of the things they suggest in there is this thing they call the 20-song challenge.
Okay.
And it's basically like you have a friend, and then you write all day,
okay,
and then get together at night and share the songs.
Sure.
And during the day,
alone though, you're writing.
Yeah,
alone?
You're writing alone.
Okay, gotcha.
And then also, you know, you're allowed to eat as much junk food as you want. Like the songs don't have to be good.
Right.
You know, they just have to be done. You just write it, and it's just about getting like, you know, getting rid of the inner critic, getting rid of the filters, just
totally.
going.
Yep.
And I've been playing music for a while, and I think for me what's happened over the years is I just kind of write less and less.
Yeah.
Like, I don't really take the time out to write, and I think a lot of my friends that are in my shoes always feel that way. Like, oh, yeah, like, writing is like one of those things like, oh, like, going to the gym or something. It's just like, yeah, I know I should do more of that, and I don't.
Right.
So, me being sort of a community person, I thought, well, it would be fun to put together an event. Sort of a selfish way for me to get a chance to write more because I need to write more.
Sure.
And so I thought of this idea. So it's so I called it Songwriter Lock-In because you lock people in. And I just borrow some office space from some friends that are running little companies.
Sure.
On Saturdays or Sundays that aren't using
yeah.
it. And so this is the third one I've done.
Okay.
And the first two actually I did a show associated with it.
Okay.
So I did a show at night when we play some of the new
oh,
songs.
Oh, how cool.
And then what we did is we did Nashville in the Round style.
Yep.
And so, which is actually the only way I do shows now anyways, but
yeah.
back then it was different. And then we'd take audience suggestions and write songs on stage too, like
super
improv
cool.
comedy style.
Yeah.
And at that point too, we were all just like, we didn't have, like we had like no filter.
Right. I mean,
it's like, it's, you just like, you don't, you actually do feel a lot lighter. Like it's cool. I didn't get that feeling as much this time. I feel like I struggled a lot this
okay.
time, but whatever. It's a journey.
And this time you guys were writing together, though, collaborating?
Mm-hmm. No, not co-writing. So that's why I rent office space, because we can all have separate little offices. And although I could hear Ian and his hysterics across the hall.
I was laughing
a little bit.
All day long.
It was, it's
just in the room by yourself laughing.
No, it was like a kid in a candy shop for me. I'm like, I haven't done this in so long.
Yeah.
Just like to be alone with the music.
I was so jealous of Ian. I was like, ugh.
And
I was like, I was just beating my head against the desk.
He's like, I'm having a hard day.
And
I'm like,
Ian's like,
bye.
You know.
What about the incentive factor? I mean, $100.
Oh, yeah. So I have people... I bring a tip jar and I have people put $100 in the jar and they get $10 back for every song they write. Which
so,
is not something you don't do. You don't like write a song, get $10, write a song.
Right.
Yeah, it's just like
at the end of the
it's
day.
It's just at the end of the day, you know, and I've never had to keep anybody's money, even that's
right.
not the point. It's just like
now, what
but
if
it,
they
is,
write
it is like
40 songs, do they get extra money?
Yeah. There's more incentive,
okay.
yeah. I'll pay you out of
just
pocket.
Wondering.
We've had people write more songs, but you know, but yeah, no, I usually am struggling to write 10 songs,
yeah.
and if the money wasn't there, it'd be easy to be like, oh, well, you know, I got 8, and one of these is
totally.
Nice.
Yeah, yeah.
But the whole point is, just it's always a battle with, like for me, it's just always a battle with, you know, the critic, and,
yeah.
and it's the worst,
absolutely.
And I feel like I struggled with that just as much or more than anybody else.
So then during the day, you guys take breaks, I would imagine, and wander around and run past each other, and do you get an update? Hey, how many have you done? And
a little bit.
Does that happen?
Yeah, okay. like it's good to, well, we also start off the day with like, led people in like a half an hour of like improv exercises.
Okay.
And we just kind of made up songs.
Oh,
and we
cool.
just got ourselves warmed
oh, neat.
Up.
Yeah, yeah.
And I think there is it is nice to check in with each other like throughout the day because it just kind of gets you out of, sometimes you can get in this weird space and then you're like, oh, people, or
exactly.
like food.
It's good to
check in with like reality over
for
once
sure.
in a while because you can get in this little bubble,
kind of
which is good
out.
Sometimes, but sometimes depending on where
And there's
at.
No like theme, the songs can be whatever you want. There's no like theme you have
yeah.
to follow. Or
what's really cool because there is no theme and because people have to write songs is people often write songs way out of the genre they usually write.
Yeah, right.
Right, which I think for me is really nice because I had a manager for a little while and I would always be like, I want to write a country song. He's like, you can't write. He's like, we're not doing country. I'm like, oh, whatever. You know, like, I just like writing different
absolutely.
Songs. And so this, and it, I've since just given my permission, self-permission to write whatever I want, but fuck that guy, man. But you know, he was great, actually. But but with this one, like, for example, you know, can I swear? Is that?
Of course.
Okay. Well, I mean, I already sweared, but in the future. like our friend Matt Heck. Oh, you know Matt Heck.
Yeah,
he came in town. He left such San Diego
cool
like 8 years ago, but
I
played a show with him last year. I stayed in touch with him, and so he came in town. He was in from LA,
okay.
And he wrote a kid song.
Okay.
Which we'd never write a kid song, and it was an awesome song. And of course, it was kind of a kid song, but it had this depth that could totally
such
fit
a good
adults.
Analogy.
Sure,
inspired.
Sure.
So it was great.
Yeah.
And you know, I've written songs as jokes. Actually, every song I've written at the Songwriter Lock-Ins that ends up being a great song was written as a joke.
Right.
Basically.
Right.
I wrote one about the inner critic.
Yeah, I wrote one of this
solid.
One.
Oh, good.
Called Fuck You, Inner Critic.
Yeah.
I'm going to have to scroll down a little bit as we do it, but that's okay. I'm going to go with it. Fuck you, inner critic. It's you I'm going to blame. I don't need your bullshit and it's driving me insane. I just wanna sing and play without you butting in, okay? So fuck you, inner critic, you're to blame. Fuck you, inner critic, cause I need another verse. I know you wanna judge it, oh, but let's finish it first. Let's just get through this today without you leading me astray. So fuck you, inner critic, you're the worst. Fuck you, inner critic, yeah, that feels so good to say. You're trying to protect me, oh, but there's a better way. Save your judgments when I'm done, then you can go and have your fun. Fuck you, inner critic, go away, yeah, yeah. Fuck you, inner critic, yeah, you really make me sick. You can help or you can leave, but please just take your pick. I got better things to do than work to try and impress you. So fuck you, inner critic, you're a dick.
Exactly.
To
do
a
it.
Classic. Yeah.
And then
so, and that song will probably stick around in my repertoire.
Oh, good. Yeah. And then at the end of the day, do you play the songs for each other?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah,
so we spend
that.
A couple
So this time we play the songs for each other. I mean, before we'd play the songs for each other over dinner and then go do the show.
Right.
I just didn't want to book the show this time. I was a little
yeah,
lazy,
that seems
but...
like a whole other big element part of it. But, I mean...
Yeah.
What
it, it is.
Thing?
And the first... I mean, the first show I did was at... We did it at Mueller College. And the second one, I just did it at my house.
Mm-hmm.
And the first one was magical.
Yeah.
Like, there was something... We had 8 people. I think we had 9 musicians, and then 8 of them performed. So we had 4, and then we put 4 new ones
sure.
up. And, you know, the suggestions, everybody played at least 1 new song. Sometimes people played 2. The audience really felt like, oh, my God, like, they just wrote this.
Right.
Like,
such
and,
a cool thing.
And they were super digging it. I had people come up to me after the show. It was, like, embarrassing, because they were like... that was the best show you've ever done. And I'm, you know, it's like I was up there playing a few songs.
Sure.
They were like, we want to go to more of these shows.
Right,
and I'm
right,
like,
right.
Hmm.
That's
okay.
So cool.
But it was
well,
great.
We would love to have you host one here at the Heritage.
Let's do it.
San Diego
yeah,
Heritage
totally.
Museum. There's lots of little rooms. That
it's, fun to,
can
it's fun to watch
in.
People be scared too.
Yeah, because it's a lot.
There's one local musician that we both know that I won't name by name, but he was. I almost had to like, I had to like sit him down and like give him some therapy beforehand. Because he was like, Dave, I just got out $100. Like, I don't know, but I don't. And he ended up not putting the money in, which we agreed is fine. It's
yeah.
Not, but he, of course, he wrote amazing songs.
Sure.
Too, but you know.
Let's face it, $100 is a lot of money for the singer songwriter.
I know, right? But that's the point. It's supposed to,
it's supposed
yeah.
to be,
you know, it's
precious.
Supposed to be a lot of money. It's
yeah.
supposed
that's
to
scary.
Be like, well, because what, you know, I mean, we can all write a song in 5 minutes if we need to,
yeah,
you
yeah.
know, and it's like.
So do you have another one scheduled as of yet?
No.
Okay, well, we'll just
like
keep
we
an eye. Yeah, keep an eye on your calendar.
Maybe you should follow the Listen Local page to
that's
find
right.
out when.
All ooh. Right, love it. And Ian, you did a songwriter event recently as well, but this was in France.
It was.
Much more bougie.
Tell me tell me about your bougie castle.
I'm sorry, I went to an office
space. Bougie castle.
Yeah.
Dude, a lock-in, though, like, I'm thinking next year, like you something in like
dungeon
that.
Dungeon in the castle.
Yes.
Oh,
man.
There you go.
Like the boiler room or something.
Right.
That's funny.
Oh my gosh. Yeah. So I hosted about 15 songwriters in this castle in Macon, France, and it was just great. You know, it was over my birthday, and like,
unbelievable.
What a way to spend your birthday. Yeah. You know, I was just like, get my friends in one place. You know, get
your chef mom.
My chef mom, who hasn't been out of the country in 25 years, to come and be a part of it and share that with my family.
And how long were you guys there?
The castle retreat was 5 days.
Okay. Mm-hmm. And did you do a similar kind of songwriting incentive thing, or did folks were just...
You know, it was really focused on collaboration.
Okay.
There was a lot of people from L.A.
A medieval that, torture, too.
That was a saying.
Big hit. No big deal.
If you don't write 10 songs, it's a little worse than not giving your 100 bucks.
Yeah. When you whip out the guillotine, people, they get right in it. Real fast. Yeah. Yeah, and so it was very focused on collaboration.
Yeah.
And, Alan Roy Scott and Nittany Paris were co-facilitators for some of the event, like, some of the exercises, and
mm-hmm.
you know, we did like the 17 song minute or songwriter exercise, and we all paired off and just like cranked out a song in 17 minutes and
Sweet.
Performed it on the castle steps, and then yeah, it was just like every day it was, you know, wake up, crack of dawn, like I was going to be like, everyone up first thing in the morning, like I'll have a fire ready in the fireplace and like walk the grounds as the sun comes up and like that layer of mist is out there, go meditate.
Incredible.
And play your guitar or like do your morning pages or whatever your morning routine is.
And then, first of all, because you're going to do this again.
Sure.
Talk cost. You know, as a songwriter, I can't go to a castle in France, but it was really pretty reasonable.
Well, this, because it was a beta run, I charged $750 a head.
Okay.
And
that's ridiculous.
I made no money at all.
Yeah,
like, I actually paid a bit out of my own pocket.
Sure,
just, you know, because I wanted to make it work and make it accessible for people to
but
come.
But I think even
it.
At $1,000 or $1,500, that's still a deal for a castle in France.
That's probably what the pricing is going to be for this next one. But with the early bird incentive, like I want to discount it and offer to teach people how I got my round trip tickets
Your
for free.
Hacks.
For my mom,
yeah.
for me, for my friend who traveled with me afterwards. Yep. Like I got these flights for taxes only.
That's right. Yeah, you've got
so
a lot of information on
If
that.
People sign up early enough when I open the early bird, I can get them the round trips for free.
Sweet.
Yeah.
Do you know what month you'll be doing it in? I know you don't have a specific date yet, but...
I have a meeting with the castle next week, but we're shooting for October again.
Okay, yeah.
Because it was
great
so nice.
Year,
like, the weather was odd. Like, they're like, we don't know what you Californians did coming here, but, like, it was the autumn colors.
Yeah.
And it was San Diego weather.
Well, really?
It was 75 to 80 every day.
Beautiful.
And it was... still and perfect, like no rain, but in the morning it was cold, and like you have your scarf and your coat.
Oh, France.
Oh, so romantic.
Yeah.
And just the grounds were stunning, you know, it was just like 600 acres of forest, and we all stayed in this cottage from like the 1600s, mm-hmm. and it was like this farmhouse, it's like two-story, like bunch of bedrooms and a kitchen, and like communal living room with a big fireplace, and we'd all wake up there, and like we'd do our morning vocal meditations, which this guy from Portugal, Edgar Valente, was leading, and it was
nice.
A great way to start the day.
Yeah.
And then you walk down this path through like this little like stone entryway through the forest, and then through the trees you see the castle materialize, and we got our guitars on our backs and our coffee, and
incredible.
And we go to this castle all day long.
You're old, that old, that
my
super
lute.
Old lute.
Yeah, that's right.
I wish I brought it.
What,
I'm
you
gonna
didn't
need
bring
to
it?
Get,
oh my god.
I know. Next time.
Are you going to go next time, Dave Booda, and will you ride your bike there?
I will try.
I'll give you a discount.
I've ridden my bike. I've ridden my bike across Europe.
That's what I was going to say. I know you are kind of a crazy...
I didn't make it to Europe on the bike. I had to fly the bike.
Sure, yeah. Darn it.
You know.
Tell me a
little
about
I would love to take a boat across, though.
Yeah.
That would be great.
Tell me about your biking.
I got into bike touring in 2011.
Okay.
I've only done two trips, actually. So 2011, without any biking experience, without really even owning a bike.
Yeah.
I bought a bike like a month before I left. I went, actually, so my friend Nick Carlton, who used to bartend at the Tiki.
Okay.
So I used to play at the Tiki every week back when PB. He did a lot of bike touring.
Okay.
He had done a couple trips, and we were talking about summer plans, and he's like, yeah, I'm going to go bike through Europe this summer. I was like, that sounds amazing. I want to do that.
Yeah.
And he was probably just thought I was full of shit, which I would think people are full of shit when they say that too. But I was like, yeah, no, I'm serious about it. And like a month later, I'm like, dude, I'm still serious. It's like, all right, look, here's what you need, blah, blah, blah.
Wow.
And it was like a group of four of us. And so we packed the bikes up, you know, flew to London, and then
so you bought a bike.
Yeah.
And you rode around here a little bit?
I was living in Bonita at the time.
There's conditioning, right? If you're going to go across Europe and...
Well, I mean, you would think they're supposed to be, but whatever. You start slow, you know. I was living in Bonita at the time.
Okay.
I bought the bike, and then I biked from there to PB and back.
Wow, yeah.
Just in one day, just to be like, see what that's like.
Your first big time out.
Yeah.
How many miles is that?
I didn't even remember how to change gears.
That's like
I don't know.
That's a lot of miles.
It's probably like 30, 35 miles.
Bonita to PB?
Okay. I think. It was nice.
And you're like, I'm into this. This is cool.
Well, I'd already decided to go on the trip, so yeah. I was pretty much into it. It was just like, I should probably just try this. So I'm not learning this. We biked. The thing about it that I didn't expect, actually, was that we free camped the whole way.
Yeah.
And I didn't know what free camping was. Nick was like, yeah, we're going to free camp. I had pretty much only, like, vacationed at that point.
Okay.
I had never, like, been a rugged traveler.
Gotcha.
And so I expected, like, I was even thinking, like, well, Nick and I, like, we play it. We hang out in Tiki at PB. We, like, pick up chicks in PB. It's going to be, like, a Euro trip. Like, we're going to be, like, going around, like, you know, partying and stuff.
Right.
I had no idea it was going to be like, I mean, it just was
survival.
Not that.
It
was like, you know, free camp, basically, there's something called stealth camping, which is basically you just throw a tent wherever you don't, you can't, you know, people aren't going to see you. It's usually dusk when you come in.
Yeah.
So, and then you just leave in the morning.
Yeah.
But we slept in some shady places. I mean, I slept under bridges and park benches and, you know, behind elementary schools. I mean, wherever, it doesn't matter.
Right.
You know, and it was kind of fun because it was like, I mean, I love it now, and I think I kind of got to love it at the time, but, like, uncivilizing yourself is really nice, you know?
Yeah.
I generally have, like a kind of moderate disdain for, like, civilization.
Yeah, 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 yeah.
So I like going back to something that's a little more, you know, just austere and, you know, it's more fun.
Yeah.
I mean, I biked here from La Jolla, you know, today. Like, it's 25 miles,
that's
I guess,
great.
Or something. But, I mean, it's... So it's fun. So yeah. And then I recently, a month or two ago, I just got back. I did a Vancouver, Canada.
What I saw, and I was so
impressed.
Which
is a classic sort of bike. A lot of people do that one.
Yeah.
But you know, I mean, that was like 45 days. I spent a week biking with a guy from France who was doing Prudhoe Bay, Alaska, which is the north coast of Alaska, down to Ushuaia, Argentina, which is the southern tip of Argentina.
Oh,
that's a classic one too, and he was doing that in a year. I've known that's the typical for that one's like 18 months.
Okay. Do you have aspirations to do that?
I don't know that I have necessarily aspirations to do something that big, but I just don't want to be gone that long.
Yeah.
I guess like 2 months is good. I was just plotting out the other day. I was plotting out what it'd be like to go from here to Costa Rica.
Wow.
But I just haven't spent much time at all in Latin America or South America. And that would be about, that was like, I think it's like 3,000 miles or something, which would probably take me like 2 months. So... And maybe like, we'll see.
Yeah.
Maybe something like that. Maybe from here to Todos Santos or something like that.
How do you guys make a living to afford the ability to live this dream life you guys are doing? What do you do, Ian?
I'm an RN.
Yeah.
That helps.
Yeah.
And then I teach quite a bit.
Yeah.
I have like songwriting coaching. I teach voice and guitar to private students.
Great. Are you accepting students?
I am.
Good.
I have some stuff.
I just had a bunch of people inquire recently about
that.
Oh, yeah. So I will send them your way.
I love it. Like, I sit people down, and it's more of like a holistic approach to like emotional aspects and like psychological aspects to the craft.
Right.
And then
not just technical.
Yeah, like it's just how you play a chord.
Right.
It's like what's going on so you can really connect to your musician self and then get a routine down to do every single day. Like, I'm all about discipline. You know?
Yeah, exactly.
And it's been really enriching.
Dave, how do you pay the bills?
I do a bunch of things. I do about two or three music gigs a week.
Okay.
Anyways, like I still just like playing, and also I've always been one of those guys that like I've never complained about playing cover songs in a bar for 3 hours.
Right,
like I like my original songs.
Yeah.
I like playing for listening rooms, but I also like people being rowdy and ridiculous and heckling them and all this shit. So that's fun for me. So I'd still do that.
Good.
And then I also am a writer. I do some copywriting. And I also teach the guitar, too. I teach some voice and things to students occasionally.
Thank you all.
Sounds like it's not as deep as what Ian does, but I do it
sometimes.
Well,
Ian's
sure
pretty deep,
dude.
I don't know. He is so deep.
So deep.
Well, I'm just so inspired by you guys. I just think what you're doing in your lives is wonderful and cool. And,
thanks,
I like watching on the Facebooks and seeing all the things you're doing. So, yes, please bring the songwriting lock-in to the museum. We would love that.
Let's do it.
And we're going to start up a music program again in the spring, and so we want to definitely have you guys in to do a set and do your thing.
That's
awesome. Where can we find you online, Ian?
IanMcCartor.com, and for information on like the Castle Retreats and the musician podcast, it's songsoldier.com.
Okay, and you're only going to be accepting a dozen songwriters for this next one, so if you guys are hearing this and you're interested in that, you need to get in touch with Ian now to get on his radar.
Yeah, just send an inquiry through songsoldier.com, okay. And like the contact me part of it.
Dave, how do we find you?
Well, I don't, you know, it's funny, I don't really promote my music much.
Right.
I kind of stopped doing that 5 years ago.
I know.
Because I just don't like promoting music, and I just decided I want to do stuff I like doing.
Okay.
I promote a lot of writing, which has very little to do with what we talked about today, but I write a blog called Buddhism.
Yeah.
B-O-O-D-A-I-S-M.
It's kind of sexy. It's all sort of sex related.
Yeah, I talk a lot about relationships.
Yes.
Not on purpose, it's just that's the thing that's on my mind a lot. And not on my mind as a like a horny guy on my mind. It's just that I don't know, whatever reason, it's been an area of life that I've feel like I've done a lot of deep inquiry about and have come to a lot of conclusions that don't jive with mainstream things
that
people like to hear about that.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. But you can just find me on Facebook, too.
Yeah. I noticed you're bringing some interesting people to Encinitas to talk, too. Recently you had Rob...
Rob Greenfield. He used to live in San Diego, down in San Diego.
Yeah.
But he's an environmentalist, too.
Yeah.
I really like him. He actually does a lot of bike touring, too.
Right.
I
was noticing that you were doing some of that stuff, too, so that's really cool.
I love bringing... So Encinitas is definitely my hub, and there's a place called Univ Studio up there, which is super great. I've played a bunch of shows there. That's where I played with Ian a couple times.
Okay.
I love bringing musicians through there. Actually, for the first time, I can put on a show there because I have a really great community there. So I can get 60, 70 people out there without much effort. So it's like, now I can tell my friends that roll through. I'm like, yeah, just come through. I'll put on a show. It'll be great.
You know, awesome.
Promote it, whatever. It's like, and that's just a really nice feeling. And Univ Studio has been a big part of it.
Tell me about Univ, because I've not been there yet. And
it's right behind this place called Good Anya. It's got this outdoor, you know, string lighty area, and then there's a actual venue indoor, you know, stage lights.
Is it a surf shop?
Well, Univ is like a clothing brand.
Oh, okay.
So it just happens to be that the studio is run by it's a husband and wife who the husband owns Univ. And the wife kind of does the venue.
Gotcha.
They kind of like, they sort of, they just kind of put it together to give them some cross promotion.
Awesome.
But it's great.
I noticed they have an open mic.
They have an open mic, I think. Mm-hmm. And
every Tuesday.
Yeah,
Tuesday,
nice.
Something like that. Mostly like high school age kids. Like
okay.
the owners have kids that are in high school.
Gotcha.
So it's kind of like they get a lot of those people.
Nice.
Which is perfect for Encinitas. There's lots
totally.
Of people out there. And,
yeah.
But yeah, no, I've been doing this for like the fifth show I've done there, maybe in the last year and a half. And so it's great. It's a really great room. Actually, so December 17th, I'm playing there.
Okay, good. I was going to ask you about upcoming shows.
Mikey Parker, who is a... I met him playing some festivals this summer.
Okay.
December 17th? That'd be great. Yeah.
Get tickets. Yeah. When's your next show, Ian?
Friday.
Okay.
Yeah. It's in La Mesa at the Public Square Coffee House.
Okay.
With the Tuned Records. They're doing a showcase.
Nice. Okay, you guys. Well, is there a song you can play for me? Because I'm dying to hear some music from you.
Why, it's funny you asked, Cathryn.
I know.
Let's get you a guitar.
Let's do it.
No, so dark and beautiful. Young, so dark and beautiful. Well, excuse my affections, but I just can't help myself. I'm hungry for what I wanna put you on the shelf. I couldn't blame you, 'cause you're just being you. You're just being you, and you're just so dark and beautiful. Well, thanks to you for putting me on down that line. You know I made my move from an empty me, choking up and
got so far.
Yeah. Thank you, Ian.
Thank you.